welcome to a new Harry's Garage, and today's car is the Bentley Bentayga you see behind me, 600 horsepower of SUV-ness. Quite a machine, but probably the perfect machine for what I'm going to do over the next few days, because I'm about to set off for Geneva, because the motor show opens there tomorrow. I'm going to do a separate video on Geneva Motor Show, sort of behind the scenes, what's actually going on, a bit of gossip and that sort of thing. And then after the show, I'm off to the French Alps, Sainte-Foy. We've been there before. I took a Ferrari FF there a few years ago, and a Jaguar XJR last year. And then I want the snow out there. I want to get to know this car better than just around the block sort of test, usual thing. So over the next few days, you'll be joining me. We'll get to know what this Bentley Bentayga is about. I'm not going to give you a tour around now because we'll know much more in a few days' time. I need to get on. There's a storm brewing. That's what the noise is in the background. And next time you join me, we'll probably be in Geneva. See you there. Okay, well, we've reached Geneva now, just on the way to the Palexpo, the exhibition halls. How many miles have we done to get here from home? Yeah, 1,080 kilometres. Average MPG, 20.9. I suppose that's all right, actually. Car like this. The weather's sort of helped, actually, because it, guys, been wet on the way across. Properly wet in France at times, and on a car like this I tend to use cruise control quite a lot, and it's very sophisticated on this Bentayga, because obviously it's got radar to keep distance from the cars ahead, but it also looks at the speed limits that displayed the signs and says, oh, I'll reduce the cruise to that speed, which all sounds, it's one of those things I think, well, this is good, until you actually live with it. And I think actually maybe it's a bit clever, because every now and then it would just put the brakes on, and in France I'd have it at 130 something kilometers to sort of slightly friendly speed, and it would decide it was raining and reduce it to 110, but it would decide when that was, and you had no warning, ding, down he went, and the cruise was set at 110. So yeah, it's a good system, but a little bit clever. But the big thing I've sort of picked up on this journey is the level of refinement with this car is high. You're very well insulated, obviously the double glazed windows, all that spray going on, don't hear a thing from the wheels in the wheel arches. And the ride quality is particularly good. People are going to compare this to the Range Rover. I know Range Rover, and I would actually say this rides better. And it helps because by having a suspension setting. Standard setting is something called, they just call it, label it Bentley setting. So it will switch between comfort and sport. Clever. Or you can put it in comfort, which I had on the way across. And then it really does ride it very well, and better than anything else I can think of in this class. So I like that. A lot. What else does it do? Strange things, for some reason this glass is doesn't seem to let anything out of it. So when I was coming up to the auto routes and I'm using my clever little badge thing to go through for the tolls, it wouldn't work through this windscreen, which all seems a bit odd. You had to wave it out the window for some reason. But yeah, all very good. What I'm going to do now is park the car up for 3 days, go into the show, and today's the filming day, and then tomorrow's the big press days, do all the launches and give a report of what's happening behind the scenes, and then we'll come back to this car 3 days time and head up to the Alps and see what more we can find out about it. So see you later. We can probably tell from the outside view we're pretty close to the resort now. So the car spent those few days in Geneva. I collected three friends from the airport, and we made our way out to here, which is Sainte-Foy. Came here last year in that Jaguar XJR, had quite a lot of fun up this bit of road. This car's a bit different, but the journey over from the airport, very easy. There's a lot of space in the back. Had no complaints from the passengers sitting behind me. A lot of space back there. One thing they did comment on was the doors are quite high, so the glass area is slightly reduced over Range Rover. And then you have these screens in front of you that, if you're not using them, they're sort of a little bit odd, but I think that's the same with all cars. But the refinement was what was really noticeable. What I'm noticing up here is, there is serious grunt from this engine. You are in no doubt that it is a 600 horsepower car. The weight of the car isn't actually that bad, 2,400 and some kilos. VW way of measuring, it's of all fluids and a full tank. But this W12 engine, there's proper punch. Maximum torque, I think, is at 1,300 revs or something. But the actual design of the drivetrain puts that engine over the front wheels, actually the other side of the front wheels. So, understeer rules on a car, road like this. But you make up with it on the street bits. It really does deploy the horsepower. It's a funny engine, the W12, because it there's a slight snarl at the top, but it never... The design of the engine being not a V12 that gives you a lovely rasp, there isn't that with a W12. It was a packaging solution. Think of it as two V6 stuck together. That's the idea that W12 made Audi or the VW group able to get a 12-cylinder engine on the quattro drivetrain. That's the idea of it. I'll show you when I open the bonnet, actually, you'll see it better then. So yeah, it's not a car to squirt up a mountain pass like this and revel in the handling. It's not that sort of car, but what it does have is that punch for overtaking. Anyway, what I'm going to do now, I'm just taking you around the car, so I'm going to go up to the resort, find somewhere to pull over, and I'll take you around some of the actual details and some of this interior, and we'll go and have a look at that in a bit more detail. One thing, there's a huge discussion point on the Bentayga are its looks, because it's quite an imposing vehicle, and people say, oh, it's really ugly, or it's, you know, they really don't like the look of it. I don't mind the look of this Bentayga, because it's a Bentley, and Bentley have always had this imposing look. They're not shy, retiring sort of cars. They're, you know, yes, it's got that great big grille, but that's what Bentleys have always had. Even blower Bentleys had an enormous grille. They're sort of showy. This car isn't that showy, particularly in this sort of colour. It's got some really trick details on it as well. If you look at the headlights, and they're these very modern LED type lights. I think they've been quite clever how they've disguised the size of this vehicle. And it has those edges over the rear wings, that typical look you see on the Bentley Continental GT. Anyway, I'm going to grab the camera now and just give you a closer look at some of the details. Yeah, there we go. They're the lights, and as you can see, the Bentley script in them. They're quite a dramatic design. This one is an indicator. Down here are sensors, the big grille, as you can see there, parking sensors, etc. And then that look and that typical Bentley vent on the front wing here, and you continue that line across, and then you get that upswept rear arch. Okay, come round the back. There, I think the design doesn't work quite as well. There are some typical Bentley traits, so the chrome round the lights like this, and round the number plates thing, and then these enormous great exhaust outlets, two of these on the W12, that have got quite a lot of work to do. But then I think, like the rear wiper, that looks a bit of an afterthought. I'd have thought it'd be tucked up under this rear spoiler or something. But anyway, you're not going to complain on this car about space. There's a huge amount of space, and I really like this bar. This is, I mean, VW Group do this on other cars, but I have to say, for keeping the luggage sort of tucked away on such a big boot, I think it's a clever idea. If I look under here, space saver size spare tyre, which is always useful in a car like this. So yeah, I like this, and also on here, I don't know if that's going to work. Right, well, that one will actually lower the suspension, so the car will actually kneel down. I don't know why it's not going to work for me. Anyway, it's not going to do it today. But anyway, that will kneel if you've got something really big you're trying to get in the back. Great big door. I like there's a low sill, easy to get into. And here, the seats adjust, so I can do this. And I've got a bit of a backrest as well. I can sort of see why rear passengers said this is a bit odd, but this does actually somewhere release. How do you do it? Can't do it. I don't know how to do it. There we go. It can come off like that, and you're left with that. But I don't know, it does link in, it's got Google Maps and that sort of thing on it, and it's got a mirror function, I'm told, so you can turn it on and you can look at yourself, and if you're putting lipstick on, which I wouldn't be doing, you can do it via that screen. Anyway, that's that. As you'd expect, soft close on all the doors. And here, well, I've been driving this a while. If you look down at the controls of the seat, I have no idea what they all do, but yeah, you will get very comfy in this car. I don't know how many way adjustment it is. The wheel, beautifully designed, hand stitched. I can't get over the size of this airbag, this tiny airbag on the wheel, and real metal gear changes, and really nice that. And the whole layout works extremely well. I'm a big fan of the head-up display as well on these cars. Another little detail, you see on this mirror, there's no surround, so the glass goes right to the edge. It's very clever, all this. And obviously the beautiful pull stops for the vents. If I just lighten it all up, there we are. Something I'm amazed at, you actually get Google Maps on all this as well. Which is bizarre when you're driving in the city and you're actually seeing the buildings that you're passing on the map. One thing, actually, I'm surprised there's no covers on here. So on the cup holders in this area here, and then this enormous great bin under here, it's all rubber, and I would have thought that would be covered. You've got another little bin in there as well, and then the armrests move like this as well. So yeah, a very, very comfy cabin. Let's have a look under the engine, under the bonnet. There we are. Now, this is what Bentley wants you to think the engine should look like. So this sort of six pots going this way, it doesn't. If I actually look here, it's very hard to see. I can't really show it on camera, but that engine is about that wide. And there's three pots here, there's six there, and there's three the other side. It's extremely clever design. It's all hidden away. Bentley really don't want, you know, it's not dressed like a Ferrari engine or something like that, but what it does is deliver serious horsepower, and that's all that really matters. And we know from the Conti GT, it's an incredibly reliable engine as well. It's now, having come up into the mountains here, it's at 19.9 mpg, so we're just on 1,000 miles, so that's what it's averaged on the trip across here. Right, again, this poor car's going to get parked up here. We're off skiing for a few days, and the next time you join me, I think we'll go to the top of Switzerland and just try it on the Autobahn. I think this car might be quite good on the Autobahn. Let's see. Okay, last time we saw me, we're up in the hills, up in the Alps. I've now done, let's have a little look, it's about 400 kilometres today. We've come all the way through Switzerland. I'll get to the right screen. 400 kilometres. And we've come all the way through Switzerland, dropped friends off at Geneva Airport, come up to Baal, right at the top of Switzerland, because I know from past journeys there's a de-restricted Autobahn here that basically goes up from Baal along the Rhine up towards Frankfurt. It's not a great time of day, actually. It's about 6 o'clock, so I'm not sure how busy it's going to be. But I'm going to have a little go in this, because I think that's where this car will really score some points, because it just has that grunt, it has that top end that I want to explore and just see how refined it is at biggish speeds. What always gets me when you go through Switzerland is, you are so speed limited in Switzerland. There's cameras everywhere, and you're doing 80 and then 100 and perhaps 120, and you just go through the border post and suddenly you're on a two-lane Autobahn with no restrictions. It's like a freedom, a utopia. Let's see what we can do anyway, because the traffic isn't too bad. It's just going to get build up a little bit of speed and see if we can go to the outer rims. I want to get at least 200 clicks up, really. So there we go, that was the high speed testing this Bentayga. Thoughts on it are, it's incredible. The horsepower is certainly there. It will build speed. I'm not quite sure what speed I got to. I wasn't when before the tire warning came up. But I think it was deep, what, 240, 250 clicks, so 140, 150 miles an hour. Very much still accelerating though. The top speed rating on this car I think is 300 kilometers an hour, 186, 187 miles an hour. Proper speed for this sort of car. But my sense was the speed was definitely there, but there was a lot of mass you were then controlling under braking. The braking, the power was there. There's a slightly soft pedal, but this car is 2,400 and something kilos. Two up, we're about 2.6. That is a lot of mass to control at high speed. And there's a bit of pitching just because of the size of the vehicle. So it's not quite as together as when I had a KN turbo. I can remember I had my particular car had ceramics on and it had a really good pedal feel on it. Solid pedal, slightly more tied down. This Bentayga is just edging towards more towards comfort than super sport, super stiff suspension at high speed, but still very impressive. Right, what we're going to do now, it's getting late, obviously it's getting dark, so we're going to park up and do the final dash for the UK tomorrow. So you'll join us then. See you then. Okay, we're back in the UK. We're on the Eurotunnel. We're about to depart. Today was a run over from Metz, so see how many kilometres we've done. I've got to wake all the systems up. Headlights. What's headlights on? Right, we've done 2,650 kilometres, so about 1,500 miles in this car now. Thrown everything at it really, been on the autoroute across to Geneva, a little bit of city drive in Geneva, and then off to the French Alps. No snow to try it out on, unfortunately, and then a dash back through Germany, etc. So we've got to know this car pretty well now. And some of the things, well, there's things I didn't like about it. With on the autoroute, the cruise control is just too clever for its own good, and it looks at road signs and will instantly adjust your speed to the road sign. Oh, has it gone to 90? That's so odd. All sounds good in theory, but actually in practice, I've just got to do some of these routes. Actually in practice, it wasn't so good, because it was recognising some road signs that were for caravans or something like that and not for regular traffic. And it would just suddenly, with no warning, put your speed right down. What else? The navigation had its moments in France as well. Not disastrous, but couldn't quite get routes, and you had a sort of like the spinning disc you get on your computer. It just had a compass, wasn't sure where it was. It was a bit of a surprise. The weight, when we were on the Autobahn, you're very conscious that you're in a 2.5 ton vehicle once the speeds get right up, and it, wow, this car can build speed if you want. I noticed when I looked back at the tape, we hit just about 150 on the Autobahn before that tire warning came up. That's a serious speed, and the way, you know, 600 horsepower, very impressive that bit. Price, when I look at the price of the car, this is a £215,000 car. That's a huge amount of money, but as I say, there was a special option on this car of £20,000 for hampers that aren't actually on the car, so we put it down to £195,000. But the positives, now there's some very big positives with this car. The word that kept coming to mind when had people in it and I experienced was refinement. It was amazingly refined from the off. Just the ride quality and the silence and the double glazed windows, and really a step above that sort of usual car in this range and of ultimate SUV. I mean, this sits right at the top of the tree, I suppose. Very impressive. And then the ride quality, to be able to have a comfort button on here and get almost S-class quality ride, I've not experienced that before in an SUV. There's normally lots of metal jumping up and down, and getting the ride quality as good as this is really hard, but this is epic for that. The quality throughout the cabin everywhere, just dripping in just beautiful workmanship. How this car is constructed, the knurled bits, the vents, the organ stops, the wheel, the lever, the stick, it's just endless. You know why it costs that much money. There is a real craft to this car and how it's been constructed. There's man hours, massive man hours in the build of this car. What else is positive about it? Well, the performance. 600 and some horsepower, you notice it. And it's, and this engine, it gives its power at the top end and gives a snarl. It's funny, being a W12, it doesn't actually have a regular V12 voice. It's like two V6, the sound. It's not as refined at low revs. A V12 normally gives a signature noise. It's none of that. But what it does do is produce the power. 900 newton meters of torque available at 1300 revs, just above Tico. I want to mention economy as well. So 1500 miles, we've averaged 82 kilometers an hour, so just over 50 miles an hour, and it's got 20.7 mpg, so 20.6, but I did 21 in 400 kilometers a minute. So I think that's actually pretty good. This engine will shut down cylinders and all the sort of clever stuff new engines do these days. So yeah, not too bad for the petrol car of this size. I did a fair bit of driving at night, and it was a big surprise just how good the lights were on this car. They're quite an imposing design on the front of the car, so it's a good job they really work. But at night, there is a real intensity and a whiteness to the light that I reckon this is has the best headlights of any car I've driven. Space, easy to live with. Swallowed four people's bags, no problem at all. More space in the back as well, adjustable seats. Yeah, I ought to mention the seats. I'm not normally a fan of massaged seats, but I am a fan of the Bentley's massaged seats. Never come across so many programs, and you can do the intensity and all sorts of things. So then the handling, when we were up in the Alps, fun road I went on last year with the XJR, this car completely different. It handles as I expected, really. It's just a dogged understeer sort of car. And that comes with the drivetrain and the fact it's got a W12 right hanging over the front wheels. It's going to be nose heavy, and that's exactly what it feels like from behind the wheel. It's not a great fun sort of car to take on a challenging bit of road, but it just makes up for it by having so much performance. And then finally, the looks. Yes, not my favourite looking SUV. It's I think I would call it imposing rather than good looking. But the positives, it's got quite a list of positives. I have to compare it to Range Rover. And there is interesting, because I thought this would be a Range Rover Plus with the drive experience. It's not. It's a Continental GT Plus experience. That was a big surprise. Range Rover has some qualities that aren't present in this Bentayga. This Bentayga actually feels like a scaled up regular SUV. You don't notice it until you step one to the other, but on the Range Rover you have much more glass area, and the glass area on this Bentayga is sort of closer, and it's not as much window depth. And I think it's to do with that top speed. To get that really high top speed, they've tried to shrink how it goes through the air to try and get maximum CD to get that high speed. That's what this car was all about and engineered to do. But it does mean that the actual drive experience from here, the view out is more conventional than it is on Range Rover. Range Rover, you sit in the roof and you look over the bonnet. And this car, you have a more or less, you're scaled up Conti GT sort of look. It's not a chrism, it's just different. It feels a little more regular, but it's been an epic car for this journey. I have enjoyed it hugely. I suppose I can't say it's an absolute five-star car, because it's mighty impressive, but will you fall in love with it? I'm not sure. You would just have it forever, though. It has this in-depth quality that it just feels it would go on forever. So yeah, that's the Bentley Bentayga. I hope you enjoyed the video. There'll be more videos coming along very soon.